well as the combustion conferences also. And he has done a lot of experiments at his lab, and today he is going to share his experience, especially on fire and combustion. And it is a unique lab which I have seen in my life, as only one lab in India having so many facilities. Now let me welcome Dr. Bhaskar Dikshit for this. Sir, please take over.
Thank you, Dr. Sridhar. It has been a pleasure to interact with you in the past decade and more than past two decades. This is an excellent opportunity for me to interact with the campus-wide community of Amity University. And I take this opportunity to thank Amity University for giving this this kind of an opportunity for me to talk to your campus people and talk about fire science and engineering, which has been to which I have got initiated nearly a decade ago. I got initiated into fire science, and I've been a combustion man, and I've worked in the area of combustion earlier. For me, the switch from combustion to fire science has been very smooth. And just for the fact that if you look at fire, fire represents uncontrolled combustion in that sense. And engineering and the scientific aspects of fire, I want to just touch upon the tip of the iceberg, you can say, of the fire scenario. Fire scenario. I believe globally, if you look at the situation of the fire safety, it has been a very prominent requirement of it has become a prominent requirement of the construction industry and other various subsidiaries and energy sector and various other places. So I want to take this opportunity to interact with all of you and to give you a glimpse of the science and engineering and the technical aspects of the fire safety, firefighting, you can say. Okay. I will also briefly touch upon this being an engineering community. I'm sure this is an engineering community, and I also want to look at what are the various employment opportunities that are available for the members of the engineering community, and what are the ways forward in this particular unique area, which has been my experience that this has been a very unique and let us say a very narrow focused area of the scientific investigations of humankind. To start with, I want to give you a glimpse of the firefighting business, you can say, or the firefighting industry, if you look at it. Now, if we look at firefighting, per se, if you look at firefighting, it even from the historical period, let's say Chandragupta Maurya period, you can take, Chanakya had mandated that firefighting is an important part of any industrial activity. Earlier in that period of Chandragupta Maurya, they had earmarked certain regions of areas which have been isolated and which were identified as the sectors where only Agnijeevis work. Agnijeevis means those people who work with fire. For example, a person who handles ironsmith, who handles ironsmithy, and similar activities where fire is an important part of the whole activity. So from that period, there has been a conscious effort by humankind to look at firefighting and be prepared for fire events. So if we look at the current scenario, if you say, at a global level, we have two major threats emerging from the fire, one of the primordial elements of the universe. One is forest fires, which even today, there is at any given point of time, there is one place or the other, a huge forest fire which is raging. be it Australia, be it the equatorial forests of Africa, there is fire, there is going to be a serious fire going on somewhere. Similarly, if you look at the built environment, even in built environment, we are becoming familiar, possibly because of the higher higher connect that has got established worldwide. We are becoming conscious of the various hazards that are given up, that are given by the fire incidents. So these are the basic major classifications. I hope I am audible and I am clear to everyone.
Sir, you are audible. You can go ahead.
Thank you, Sridhar. So one feedback is important. Otherwise, I feel I am talking to myself after some time.
No, others are muted, but they are giving me already inputs. They want to see your. Somebody is worried that you are not showing PPT still.
Is it? I have shown. In fact, I have given PPT as a show. Why it is not displayed? Is it not displayed?
It's not displayed. You can just click on that. Share content, voila.
I was talking about the overall scenario of the firefighting and its classification. I wanted to give you a universal perspective of the fire scenario, where you can have a look at what are the various at what levels you have the firefighting being addressed. If you look at built environment, we can there are two basic classifications we can look for. One is the investigations that happen for post-fire events, and the other one is the firefighting systems which make us safe. When I say firefighting systems, there are various ways in which these firefighting systems are put in place. All of us are familiar with various firefighting systems that we would have seen in and out of, probably in your own campus community. You would have seen so many firefighting systems that are in place. And especially if you look at the built environments, especially multi-story built environments, there are certain mandatory requirements that are to be followed if permissions are to be granted for people to live in such environments. So once they are followed, then only people are permitted to live there. These firefighting systems which are in place are normally performance based or standards based. When I say standards based, there are certain global voluntary organizations who write various steps on how the firefighting systems should be put in place. Also, that is one way of looking at installing the firefighting systems. They are prescribed standards, which is probably the major way in which things are happening presently. The other way of installing firefighting systems is to look at their performance even before the system is in place, whether those systems perform and meet the end requirements. That can be assessed using simulation software and various other mechanisms. And once the performance is assessed, then only the firefighting systems are put in place. So either performance based or standards based, the firefighting systems can be employed. Now, these firefighting systems are classified into two categories. One is for fire suppression and the other one is for fire protection. What is the difference? See, when I say suppression, that is the active interaction with the fire when the fire event happens. That is where we look at suppression. What do I mean by active interaction? In the first few minutes, when the fire occurs in any place. See, the question is not if the fire occurs. The question is when the fire occurs. There is a certainty involved there, statistical certainty. There may be buildings which have not seen fires for the past 100 years, maybe. But there is always a way in which the fire finds its final control over the human built environment. That is because of the energy use, various other requirements are there. So suppression. So we must be prepared for suppression. What are the things that are available for us to suppress fires? One is dry chemical, one is water. Water is the main firefighting stuff. Dry chemical powders like mono ammonium phosphate and various other derivatives of it, and some silicon derivatives. Now, all of you remember, if you go to a film theater, you would have seen buckets filled with mud. I'm reminded of a bucket filled with mud, which is used to, which is put on fire to extinguish the fire. I am reminded of a famous incident of our Mysore Palace in Karnataka. Mysore was the capital at earlier, in the earlier times. All of you are familiar with the Mysore city, which is, it is famous for its palace. The palace was burned down. It's a beautiful palace, which was burned down due to a fire incident, and people did not have water. So what they did, they threw mud and water mixed with mud onto the fire to bring down the intensity of the fire. So that even at the earlier times, we have seen such incidents. Okay. So for fires, especially cellulosic fires, fires which involve combustion of wood, we use water or special chemical powders manufactured to extinguish fire. Okay, that is one class of suppression that is involved. Now, what are the other types of fire events we are familiar with? The most visible, familiar, or most, let us say, dangerous, you can say, most dangerous and most long duration fire events that is involved is oil fires. Oil, especially in the energy sector, oils are stored in large quantities, and a lot of safety is practiced. In spite of that, all of us are familiar with tank fires, which burn for large durations. When I say tank fires, huge storage tanks where crude is stored or processed fuel is stored. When there is a fire incident in such situations, we cannot use water there. What can be used there? Something which will float on oil. When I say oil, most oils, most combustible oils will have specific gravity less than one. So if you throw water on it, it cannot extinguish that fire. Why? Because water will simply go and sit in the bottom. Oil will float on the water layer. So what is done? We need to make water lighter. How do we make water lighter? Mix water with air. Simple. Mix water with air, you get foam. So how is the foam obtained? Exactly same way in which we obtain foam for our household applications for washing clothes. We use foam bubbles, right? Foam bubbles are there. The foam bubbles form once you mix certain soap to water. Exactly similar, but engineered. Engineered foams are used where water is mixed with about 3% of foam concentrates, and the resulting liquid is, it will expand water to 7 times to 20 times. They are called low expansion foams. Volume 1 liter of water expands to 7 times to 20 times that. Let's say 50 liters of water. Up to 50 liters of water, it can expand. So that large volume will bring down its mass considerably. So when you throw foam onto the oil fire, it will simply float on that and then create a foam blanket. And the end result is the foam is, the fire is extinguished within no time. So that is one suppression technique that is used. Similarly, there are other gas-based suppression techniques are used. Where this gas-based suppression techniques are used, when I say gas, gas means that gas which does not burn. That gas which does not burn. So what will happen? Suppose the most common gas that will not burn is carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide stored in containers can be thrown on fire, so that what will happen? Oxygen and fire, oxygen and fuel will get separated by a carbon dioxide layer, and in the process fire will get extinguished. These are the four major techniques that are used for suppression. Anything will be a derivative of that. For example, instead of gas, which is, I mentioned carbon dioxide, there can be other gases like halogen derivatives. Many halogen derivatives are non-combustible. So those non-combustible gases can separate oxygen, which drives the fire reaction, from the fuel. which is a gaseous form which is obtained during the fire event. The gaseous form of fuel that is obtained during the fire event. Once the separation occurs, fire is dead. That's how separation happens. So this is one class of firefighting systems which are performance or standards based, which are put in place even before the building is occupied by human beings. Okay, this is one class. The other class involves fire protection. When I say fire protection, this involves protecting what? Protecting structures, protecting exits. When I say exits, doors, windows, and also there could be air conditioning duct running through the building. There could be a cable that is running through one room from another room. In between the rooms, there will be a hole opening, and that has to be protected. That will also be an exit or entry point to the fire. So those things have to be protected. Then what else have to be protected? Interiors. When I say interiors, it will involve huge amount of combustibles. Those combustibles can be cellulosic, wood derived combustibles. They have to be protected. And then textiles like wall drapings and other curtains, those are textiles. They have to be protected. Personal protecting equipment, PPEs, they are made up of special textiles which withstand fire. So these are the protections that we are looking. These are the four major. Once again, I am very specific. These are the four major elements which will provide protection. So here, protection work passively, while suppression involves actively. These are the two major terms which form the base of the fire industry. So fire suppression, fire protection. Okay, this will give you a general idea about the firefighting industry. Let me also briefly touch upon forest fires and fire forensic investigations. Post fire events, what are the things we want to look at? Post fire, once the fire occurs, what are the things we want to look at? We want to look at how the fire has happened, or the why fire has happened, whether the fire has happened due to a natural cause, or whether the fire has happened due to arson, whether the fire has happened due to any other reasons other than natural causes. All these things we want to look at. So investigation should happen. Okay, so that also forms a major part of the firefighting, because we want to prepare for the posterity. At the same time, we also want to look at how punish the culprits, punish the guilty. They are important part of our human life, right? Similarly, if you look at forest fires, how forest fires are extinguished, that also we should look at. How do you fight a forest fire? There are several techniques for fighting forest fires. Normally, set a fire to fight a fire. That is one very common technique that is used, especially in grasslands and other places, where we use fluid dynamic principles to look at, suppose there is a wind in one direction, you create one more fire in other direction, so combustibles are all exhausted, and it will create a narrow corridor where the fire will come to end. So that is one technique. Also, nowadays there are new developments where they use special gels which are mixed with water and thrown like bombs in using helicopters in the large areas where huge fires are raging, so that the gels will stick onto the wood surface and cool the wood surface and bring about fire safety. Several techniques are there for firefighting or forest fire. One other major aspect of firefighting industry, let us say, is fire simulations. What do I mean by fire simulations? Fire simulations are used for two purposes. One is life and property safety, in that order. So fire simulations are basically used to check whether evacuation is possible in a particular high-rise building, whether evacuation is possible, whether evacuation is possible within certain time. Now, what is the time we are talking about? One major time element in the fire science is 3 minutes. Any fire in the current scenario, any fire, if it's started, the time that is available normally for people to escape from the fire zone is just 3 minutes. Fire is small, but once it goes out of the control, when I say goes out of control, it means our first aid measures. What are the first aid measures? We have a fire extinguisher. Use water to throw on fire. You would use dry chemical powder to throw on fire. Use foam to throw on, like that, various techniques. Once they are off, then we have only 3 minutes to escape. So all fire simulations, especially life safety based fire simulations, involve tracking manning pins or human movement at a normal speed, whether from a building, from a high-rise building or from a large building, whether person can escape to the nearest exit, fire safety exit, within 3 minutes. That is how we looked at fire simulation for life safety. Then the second aspect of fire simulation involves smoke transport, smoke movement. Like, you know, a building will have various air passages from point A to point B, how the draft exists. And is there any draft-free corridors through which people can escape? Like that, there are several simulations are possible. So this is a busy slide actually. This would have given you some basic idea about all the assets of the firefighting industry. It is built over time. As long as the first human being first started using fire, we have learned to work for human safety, especially when we look at built environments. Okay. So let me look at the science and engineering of firefighting briefly. I have talked about solid fuel fires. I have talked about fires earlier. Solid fires could be from solid fuels or oil and gas fires. Now, what is the difference between the two? In solid fuel fires, there is always release of gaseous fuels from solid fuels, and the gaseous fuels mix with air and burn. While in oil or gas fires, when I say oil fires, normally tanker fires, when tankers catch fire, fuels will evaporate and then the vapors will mix with air and combustion is established. In gas fires, we have normally propane and other high level other vapors, which are directly vapors at atmospheric pressure. Fires involving that are called gas fires, where fuel is directly available. Now, how do you fight all these classes of fire? The basic strategy of fighting fire involves removing heat. That is, you cool the fuel or remove the heat source. The second one is isolate oxygen. That is, you create a blanket or you create a difference between a non-combustible layer between a fuel and oxidizer, which is basically oxygen in atmospheric air. Then isolating the fuel or removing the fuel from the fire source. These are the three basic techniques that are used in fighting fire. Now, let us look at the science and engineering of how we achieve this. If you look at active firefighting, we look at suppression. Okay, we look at suppression of fire. Now, one single important element which I have recognized for looking at suppression of fire is application density. This is a term, scientific term, which is a part of major vocabulary of all firefighting industry. I will briefly describe to you how important this term is. What is application density? We all understand density, right? You know, that is, what is density? So many kilograms per unit volume, that is density. Now, likewise, we talk of population density. What is population density? Suppose in this COVID times, we look at population density of, let's say, city of, let's say, India. It is 420 people per kilometer square area. About 420 people live in every, that is the kind of density we are looking at here. So application density. Similarly, in case of fire, when I say application density, what is application density? It is the amount of the material which you want extinguish, you put on or you apply onto the fire. Now, let me give you an example. Suppose you have a pan of about 2 meter by 2 meter area, 4 meter square area, you have a pan. Now, what is the rate at which you want to apply the extinguishant onto that so that the fire is extinguished? If the rate is lower than this, then the chances of fire getting extinguished is not there at all. You know why? You know why? Because as the extinguishing process happens, if the extinguishant rate is not sufficiently high, if the extinguishant dispensing rate is not sufficiently high, fire will continue to rage on because it will continue to get its fuel. It will continue to get its fuel. So therefore, there is a minimum rate at which you have to apply. Now, what is that minimum rate? For example, you take oil fires. When we talk of foam dispensation on oil fires, we talk of an application density of about 0.2 gallons per minute of flow rate of foam is a minimum requirement. That if you supply per meter square area, per square feet, 0.2 GPM per square feet. That is the kind of application density that we look at in case of foam throw area. Similarly, if you look at wood fires, like crib fires or wood fires, we need to put an application density of at least 1 liter per minute of water flow per square meter of exposed wood area. If it is not provided, then it is not possible for us to cool the fire sufficiently fast so that the fire will get extinguished. That is another point I want to bring to your attention. So in suppression, the requirement is application, the scientific part that we need to address is the application density. Of course, the first aspect is choice of the extinguisher. Choice of the extinguisher. You have to choose the right extinguisher. And the second option is the rate at which the extinguisher has to be applied. Application density. These are the points on suppression, the scientific aspects. And the engineering aspects. The science refers to the choice of the extinguisher. And the engineering refers to the rate at which you need to apply the extinguisher. At least to my understanding, that is what I think I want to share with you on this. Next, on protection. When I say protection, I refer to those actions we take to prevent or to make the to prevent or to make the fire burn slowly. The protection happens because of two things. One is initial onslaught of ignition that is necessary for the fire to start is high. That is one thing. The second part is when the fire occurs, nothing can prevent the thing. When I say fire retardancy, it does not mean it becomes non-combustible. No. Let me give you an example. Suppose I have a normal curtain made up of cotton. It will burn with certain heat incident radiation. Now, for the same cotton, if I coat it with a layer of, let's say, plaster of Paris or some other material, gypsum powder, some other material with certain thickness, then what will happen? It will require little more intensity of radiation before it catches fire. So what will happen in the process? That higher intensity of radiation may not be there at all in the initial point, so it will not catch fire. That is one advantage you get. The second advantage you get is even when it catches fire, it will burn little slowly. It will burn little slowly. What is the advantage with that? When it burns little slowly, the untenable condition is reached little later. So people will escape from the fire area faster. So therefore, protection is afforded in this direction. So here also, in fire retardancy, we need to look at these aspects. In fire retardancy, what is the scientific aspect we need to look at? Let me bring it to your attention. In fire retardancy, there are two counteracting actions that are going to happen the moment you introduce fire retardancy into the fire safety thinking. What are those? Once you introduce fire retardancy, there is a possibility of release of more obnoxious, more polluting gases into the fire room, into the room which is involved in fire. So that is on the one hand, you will get reduction, you will get increased time for escape. On the other hand, you will get certain obnoxious gases which will impair your thinking when the fire occurs. So it will impair your thinking, because once there are certain chemicals, certain dangerous chemicals which are released when we go for, I mentioned POP as an example. Nobody uses plain simple POP for this action. They use all kinds of adhesives, all kinds of complex chemicals involving polyvinyl chloride and other derivatives of it, so that the retardancy becomes higher, the fire retardancy becomes higher. So under such circumstances, it becomes necessary for us to do a scientific analysis or investigation, or a kind of a trade-off. We say, okay, this fire protection is better, this much fire protection let us do. So why I am telling you all these things is, you must recognize the involved aspects of the fire science. There are certain involved aspects of fire science which will require careful thinking, which will require incisive minds, young incisive minds, to work on them, so that you will have enough opportunities to work on. So therefore, the fire retardancy becomes important. Fire protection is a major business. I think people with fire-rated doors, I'll come to it a little later. There are many avenues where fire protection are necessary to be provided. Okay. Now, let me also look at, like I mentioned, let me also little continue on the fire science, so that we give you an inkling of of the aspects of fire. If you look at fire science, fire basically represents uncontrolled combustion, and it involves widely varying fuel composition. It involves widely varying fuel composition. What do I mean by that? Our drawing room composition has changed from plain wood or cellulosic materials, which was probably in 1980, we would be very happy with a wooden chair and a sofa. Sometimes sofa were not to be there. It would be simple chape or some ground level textile on which we would sit. Textile layer on which we would sit. But today it is not so. We have very complex, very comfortable, very plush drying rooms, which will have chemicals. The chemical composition of that is quite dangerous, to say the least. So the composition of the fuel, basically what burns, all of us know, what burns? Only compounds of carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. It burns. Maybe some sulfur, if it is there, we don't know. And some other small chemical additives that will happen. So carbon, hydrogen and oxygen, same carbon and hydrogen and oxygen in different forms burn differently and produce, and also some nitrogen, if it gets into it, it will produce very dangerous gases, cyanides. It will produce very all kinds of cyanides. Methyl isocyanate is a famous case in point. So various dangerous chemicals are produced when the fires occur also. So when we look at such a situation, emissions become very dangerous. And also at the same time, bringing about or designing fire safety is not simple. How do we design fire safety in a situation where there is a fuel which has an energy content of 38 to 40 megajoule per kilogram, while wood has a typical energy content of 20 megajoule per kilogram? There is a wide ranging thing. So how we do it? One of the major scientific aspects, investigative aspects that have been brought out is, we look at wood equivalents to normalize everything. When you say fuel, okay, you have different types of fuels, different types of fuels burning. We will all look at wood equivalent of that. Say suppose you have a fuel with an energy content of 30 megajoule per kg, then it is 1.5 times the wood energy content. So that means if you have 1.5 kg of that material, it is equivalent to 1 kg of wood, something like that. Or maybe other way around, 0.75 kg is equal to 1 kg of wood, something like that. That is what I mean by Wood equivalent. So equivalent conversions are made. That is one technique that is used in when the fuel compositions are widely varying. I mentioned about smoke and poisonous gases that occur and its effect on human thinking, how it gets impaired and create problems, and how we need to address that, and which we have to work. There is a work available for people to do on. Okay. Then the next important aspect that has gone into the fire safety design systems design is developing the oxygen equivalent, equivalent oxygen. What do I mean by equivalent oxygen? See, let us examine the fire event. Now, what happens in a fire event? There is fuel, there is oxidizer, fuel and oxidizer mixes and they burn, releasing energy. And mixes, they mix and burn, releasing energy. Now, if fuel has different energy contents, then the amount of energy released will be different. Right. So therefore, it is not easy at all to design the system, because any given day, if there is a built environment, we don't know what is its composition, given the fact that multiple types of materials are likely to enter our drawing rooms. So what was done? One very elegant thing was found by fire engineers in 1977, around 1977 period. This was discovered, that when fire engineers were discussing things with the biologists found a very interesting thing, where there was a certain level of bacteria which were consuming oxygen. They were finding out the amount of bacteria development based on the oxygen the bacteria were consuming. So that gave an idea for people in the fire industry to identify and come out with a new idea called oxygen equivalent. So oxygen is common, whatever burns in fire, oxygen is common. So they said, okay, let us look at oxygen equivalent. So we say, if in a fire event, 1 kilogram of oxygen gets consumed, that means energy released during that fire is about 13.1 or 13.2 megajoules. So it is a rough way of saying energy content of oxygen is 13 megajoules per kilogram. So that became a major driver for the fire science. So a lot of research aspects are supported by that, and new technical developments took place because of this oxygen equivalent concept. This is one development that took place in the fire industry. The other important development that I also want to mention to you is the plate thermometer. What are the parameters we need to measure during the investigate or to understand the fire behavior? Temperature is one important parameter that we need to measure. The other important parameter that we need to measure is heat flux. One is temperature, other one is heat flux. Both the parameters can be assessed using a technical element called plate thermometer, which is a simple, I have shown you a simple plate thermometer structure here, which is universally accepted, and also it is percolated into various standards. People who write standards have got it into their documents now. This is a simple 100 mm by 100 mm square plate with about 10 mm thickness, with a simple insulation of about 1400 kg per meter cube, yes, density, high density, simple insulation, ceramic wool fiber insulation. And a thermocouple is mounted on that at the center, and the temperature that this records can be used to derive. Only condition is the heat transfer coefficient across this plate and the heat transfer coefficient of a single thermocouple bead, if they are considered equal, which is not true, but if they are considered equal, then the temperature, based on the temperature, we can derive the heat flux onto this surface. This is one important development in the fire industry. Okay, this plate thermometer is essential to test or establish the fire protection afforded by various structural elements that are used to bring about fire safety in the built environment. How do they do it? Normally, what is done is the specimen, let us say it is a fire door or some such device, is placed onto the in a furnace, and the furnace is allowed to undergo a temperature excursion, which is exactly similar or nearly similar to the kind of temperature excursion the fire door is likely to go through in an event, in an actual fire event, and still withstand the fire event. Suppose, what do you do? Suppose you have a room, you something happens in the room, and a fire starts in the room. Now you don't want the fire to spread into your hall or other area. So what do? You come out of the room and close the door. Now what is necessary? The door must withstand the fire for a sufficiently long period, so that the fire will burn and die down, and then people can open the door and go in. That is the basic idea, isn't it? So to solve that, to get to that position, we need to test whether the door can withstand such a fire. So what we do? We look at a temperature excursion which the door is likely to go when a room of a certain fire load, when it is subjected to, or when the fire is lit in that room, or when a fire incident has happened in the room, the door is subjected to a similar situation. How? Using a furnace. Now, how do we know what kind of temperature excursion it occurs? People have made temperature measurements, and they have established a time temperature curve. I'll show it little later. So you provide and then check that the door, yes, this door can do. What happens in the actual door event when the fire is subjected, when it's subjected to, it must not leak gases out, because if the gases are leaked out of the door, it will cause problems, or the other areas might become involved. So like that, temperature curves are there. I'll show it later. Then that is one part. Then the other part is life safety. How do we bring about life safety in a fire situation, especially in large buildings, multiple occupancies, multiple different type of occupancies? People do what is known as simulation. So this is where science is involved. So in all these areas, technical expertise is essential for people to work on. Okay, here is an example of a typical time temperature curve to which the fire elements. What are the fire elements I'm talking of? Passive fire protection elements. What are those elements I'm talking of? It could be a fire door, it could be a fire hatch, or a top cover, and then it could be a fire stop, or it could be a damper, which is used in industrial buildings. It could be a damper, or it could be a cable stop. A cable stop is one where, you know, a duct enters from one building to another, or a cable tray enters from one building to another. In between, that is a compromised area. In that area, they use a cable stop, which will prevent hot gases from entering from room A to room B, or area A to area B, so that area B gets sealed when there is a fire. Now, where such things are essential, especially in large ships, let us say, submarines, ships, in such situations, everything is enclosed there. Such safety precautions are very essential. Now, here I have given you an example of two different curves. You can say the red one is a cellulosic curve, where buildings are subject there. You know, normally when a building is subjected to a fire incident, the temperature, of course, a building with an equivalent of 25 kg equivalent of fire load, let us say, the standards permit certain fire load to have a certain classification. Okay, let me briefly talk. Having said that, let me briefly talk about what is this I'm talking on classification. Say, suppose you have a fire zone. People say there's a high risk zone, A, B, C, D, like that. They classify a municipal area and then say this is a high risk area. For example, if you go to areas like Peenya, where energy consumption is high, energy sector is high, there they have to follow certain special norms to bring about fire safety. In residential areas, there is a lesser stringency employed. So based on that, we look at providing the fire safety. So if you look at a cellulosic curve, let us say, for a particular classification, temperature rise versus time. Okay, you have a 3-hour rated, you need to go for a 3-hour rated fire door, you can say, or you need to 1-hour rated fire door is sufficient. So like that, different rating fire doors and fire devices are prescribed based on the requirement of the area classification. Okay, I have listed here parameters of significance which are necessary in case of measurement that are done in case of fire events. Temperature is a basic measurement that is done. Normally thermocouples are employed for measurement of temperature. And I assume the people come here from who are participants have a general idea about temperature measurement. That is one critical requirement. Similarly, heat flux, velocity, fuel flow rate, pressure, emissions, and obscuration. What do I mean by obscuration? When there is smoke, the visibility comes down. But it is important for us to quantify what is the visibility. So this is called smoke obscuration. So why it is important for us to recognize this obscuration? It is important for us because there the science involved in obscuration is if a person is in a dark room and if he is not able to see a signboard, then he may not be able to escape. His life is in danger. So they say that there should be certain level of visibility that is required to be provided. Similarly, emissions are to be measured. Obscuration is to be measured. Similarly, emissions are to be measured in a fire. How do we measure emissions? What are the emissions that we need to measure? We look at emissions like emission of CO, and then emission of NO and other dangerous chemicals like cyanides, if there are any cyanides, depending upon what is burning. All these emissions are required to be measured. They are normally quantified in ppm, parts per million. Pressure flow rate, we understand. Velocity is another important quantity that is measured because air flow rate is an important parameter which affects the fire safety, especially in high-rise buildings. It's measured. Similarly, heat flux. Heat flux is normally from the fire background. Heat flux is normally measured using plate thermometer. Okay. Let me
talk. Sir, 7 minutes left. Sir, please.
Okay, sir. I will. Yes, I am just looking for my watch. I thought I spent a lot of time, so I just thought I would watch. So heat flux is one important parameter which will affect the fire, the ignition of fire. So what ignites is a question that we need to look at. See, as you can see, we can ignite thin items if the heat flux is about 10 kilowatt per meter square. That is the kind of thing. Now, what is 10 kilowatt per meter square? If you understand, now we are in peak summer. If you stand out in the sun, what you get onto your body, the radiation is about 1 kilowatt per meter square. So if your intensity is 10 times that, then that will ignite thin material, thin items. Thicker items will require little higher flux. Now, how do we, I think whatever we discussed till now will give you an overall idea about how the fire, the science and the scientific aspects of fire have touched upon. Now, how do we bring about, what about implementation? How do we implement this safety? So people, voluntary organizations, groups of voluntary people, voluntary bodies, they develop, maintain, and update various standards for various requirements for fire protection schemes. Various requirements which will prescribe what kind of fire protection schemes are necessary for various situations. Now, if you look at what are those, I'll give you some examples. NFPA is a US-based body. Underwriters Laboratories, Factory Mutual, National Fire Protection Association, Underwriters Laboratories, Factory Mutual, International Civil Aviation Organization, and of course our own Bureau of Indian Standards. They are such bodies which will create a voluntary document. Now, when I say voluntary, the people who want to live there can think of what is required for them and adopt from them. There are certain things which are voluntary. There are certain things which are mandatory. Now, who says which are mandatory? Local municipal bodies. They say which are mandatory. So like that, we adopt and these things are enforced by local municipal bodies. Now, and what is the effect, end effect of this? One of the people who benefit from this adopting of the fire safety is directly the manufacturer, the person, the owner of the building. How? Because his insurance premium will be low. Insurance risk is assessed based on the amount of fire safety that is provided, or insurance itself will not be permitted if the certain basic fire safety parameters are not met, certain compliance is not met. Then conformance to standards and verification of claim for new products. These are the two elements, insurance and conformance to standards and verification of claims for new products involve testing. Now, insurance people don't accept until and unless a certain safety, the safety aspects of a certain product, fire safety product, is confirmed, verified, and tested. So, fire testing is an important part and parcel of this fire business. Okay, this is about standards and testing I want to touch upon. Now, the other important point which I also want to share with you is the aspects related to high-rise buildings. Now, when I say high-rise buildings, what are these high-rise buildings? High-rise buildings are those structures where the height can have a serious impact on evacuation. That is a very broad definition of high-rise buildings. So this is one must recognize this. See, in for example, a simple example I have brought out here. Hyderabad, 4 floors is considered as high-rise. Hyderabad municipality mandates the 4-floor building is high-rise. They have to provide all this. Now, where is that high-rise coming into picture? Here also is another important point is a firefighting agency may not have a sufficiently high ladder beyond 4 floors. While in certain large areas like New York, large cities like New York, San Francisco, they may have a reach available where people can be evacuated from a height of 40th floor. Beyond that, it is high rise. So evacuation is not planned beyond that. So you need to provide sufficient time, like a fire stop floor or something. There are various parameters that can happen. So there is sort of scientific aspects involved there. Fire safety assessment for such buildings are normally performance based. Okay. Having said these important points or the related thing, let me expand a little on testing. Briefly, I will tell you. I have listed in various major labs of fire suppression testing is listed here. This PPT will be shared with all of you, I'm sure. And you can look at that and where I have given a comparison of the capabilities of various labs across, let's say, in UL, in Northbrook, Waterloo. These are all for fire suppression, testing of the fire suppression products. Let me also give you a glimpse of our own UL Jain Fire Lab, where you see a view of the fire lab is provided. This is a unique facility, which is different from the labs otherwise, where else in the world. In the fact that this building uses a natural ventilation for fire. See, when you do testing of the fire products, like I mentioned to you, there must be a fire safe fire. There must be a typical standard fire which is lit, and then that fire is extinguished. That standard fire must have enough oxygen. That is provided in this double staggered arrangement which I have shown here. This is a velocity contour because, mind you, when you do fire testing, it is an indoor fire testing, and an indoor fire testing is a requirement of the standard. So when I say indoor fire testing, it must be indoors. What is an indoor area where fluid velocities are zero? There is no ambient air disturbance. So this represents a simulation of the indoor fire lab which I have shown you just now, where you can see in the central region, velocities are very low. Experiments were carried out for measurement of velocities, and we found that the velocity in the central region is nearly zero. We have also looked at wall temperatures, whether they are detrimental to the civil structure, and we found no, it is not detrimental. For the kind of fire tests we have done in such a laboratory, the temperatures reached is less than 100 degrees in such a situation, so the fire is safer. I will briefly touch upon fire 4 and 6 here. Also, I have already discussed a few parts, the important points I have listed out here. NFPA 921 is a global standard, globally accepted standard which lays out general procedures on how fire safety investigations are carried out. Now, investigating what causes the fire incidents are normally investigated. Now, we should differentiate between arson and natural causes. And two examples I want to show here. Behavior of fire and smoke alarms can be assessed after fire event, because when there is a smoke alarm, there is a vibration. Now, when there is a vibration, smoke will not deposit on that. So if the alarm is black, then it has worked. It has not worked because it has not vibrated. Alarm diaphragm is not vibrated. As simple as that. Let me share this with you. Then also, what causes fire, whether it's natural or artificial, we will not be able to, you know, say a priori, because there are certain incidences where, you know, an ambient temperature sawdust heap has caught fire on its own because of the inner reactions in the core. Temperature at 50-60 degrees provide enough reactions to bring about a small smoldering, and then it will accelerate into an actual smoke, actual fire. So people must be aware of these things. Those are into fire forensics. Now, let me also share with you some important points who are the stakeholders who need this fire expertise. Now, energy sector is a major player, where especially oil, ONGC, IOCL, BPCL, Reliance, all of them require expertise in fire safety. Power plants, all major power plants will invariably require fire engineers to look at fire safety, people with their competence in fire engineering. All renewable energy industries, their competence. Process industries, large process industries who handle storage of huge amount of chemicals. Food industries, where they play with fire day in and day out. Our own kitchen, in that sense. Kitchen fire protection is a major business nowadays. Warehouses, where they store large amount of fuels, they are important. Transportation sector, airports, harbors, they require fire safety professionals. Now, what is happening is people from other walks of life are co-opted into fire industry. People with motivation in the same stream will definitely have an edge over them. Construction industry, both public and private. If you look at, let's say, a metro construction, especially tunnels, fire safety of tunnels is a major problem. How do you provide fire safety? You go for high expansion foams, cover the ends of the tunnel if there is a fire in the center, allow the people to come out, and then cover the ends, so oxidize it. Lot of techniques are there. Then flood it with gases, things like that. Installation of fire protection products, smart cities planning, where you require expertise there. Local municipal bodies, they require for inspection and fire response, both.
Excuse me, sir. I think you may conclude and then come to the videos, please.
Just give me 2 minutes. I'll do it. Then standard organizations, research and development, insurance companies, they require that. Then what are the competencies we require from fire engineer? Here I want to stress upon one very important point. If people want to be part of the fire engineering group, then the physical and mental agility, skills to tackle problems under any circumstances, that mental tenacity is very essential. I have found mental tenacity comes from physical exercise. Mental tenacity is very important. So physical fitness and agility is very much stressed upon. One of the major places where fire training happens is in National Fire Service College in Nagpur. Any talk on that is not go without mentioning that is not right. There, they have a special wing where every day engineers look at physical agility of people. Now, I want to briefly summarize. I want to show you two interesting videos. The general summary, I think what we have covered is the technical aspects of fire science and engineering, and the major stakeholders who are looking out at the expertise in fire science and engineering I have listed. This PPT is shared with you. You can look at that. I want to also show you two important aspects of two videos that will give you insights into the fire testing and fire forensics. One is, I want to show you this video. Can you see this video, sir? Hello?
Yes, sir, visible.
Yeah. want you people to watch this video from the beginning. I think you have seen. You see, suddenly fire comes. There is no fire. What you saw in the initial stage was a toppling of a container of, let's say, kerosene. It is a container of kerosene which is toppled, and you saw suddenly fire raging. I also want to take an important aspect related to that. You can see that as the video plays out, is it playing out now?
No, it is not playing now.
Okay, so I'll play it again. If you see the video, you can see that, is it playing now? Yeah,
it's playing.
The toppling happening, and there is an acceleration happened. Some time is about, it took about 2-3 minutes. It is not this fast. So you see a light there at one corner. There is a lit deepam. There is a lit deepam, and the vapors from the fuel will travel here, and then the fire is lit. Now people must be agile enough to recognize the fact that a naked flame, a deepam which is there in the puja room, can ignite a woman who is cooking fuel in the kitchen because of a toppled kerosene or highly evaporating container. Enough time is given, and that the vapors, enough, it will be possible, enough air fuel oxidizer mixture, and that that can cause. So therefore people must be very aware of these things. Now I want to close my talk, if time is there, by showing one video of our lab, of activities that are happening in our lab. Is it okay, sir?
Please run it.
Several measurements in our lab I have shown you.
Thank you very much, sir. There are a few questions from our participants here.
Most welcome, sir. I was very disappointed that there was no time for interaction. I'm glad you are giving me some time for interaction.
We will have it. How to suppress fire when it is about to go into the backdraft? What are the safety measures and equipments important to fight fire in a backdraft?
Backdraft.
Yeah.
That is one of the most dangerous fires, you can say. And there is a backdraft or a reverse draft, you mean. There is a draft occurring against the engineer or against the firefighter. So normally what is done in such situations is the roof access is, if it is available, the roof is punctured so that people should not enter. So let me also tell you what is my understanding of backdraft, so that people will also, and others who are listening also will understand what is that. Suppose there is a room, and there is a fire in the room, and there is combustibles, all combustibles are exhausted. Oxidizer is exhausted. There are combustibles, hot fuel is available, vapors are available in the room, there is no oxygen. So the firefighter, if he enters the room by breaking the door, then he is dead, because air will enter along with him and entire things will catch fire immediately. So under such circumstances, the only way in which we can fight fire is by puncturing the roof and allowing the combustibles to escape, and then people can enter the facility. This is one understanding. I don't know whether I have answered the question which the participant asked.
Sir, there is another question here about the apartments. Do you believe that the materials and styles used in modern architecture encourages widespread more than the old architecture?
Yes. There is if you can Google for UL fire test, and you will find a very outstanding video in which they compare a 1980s building and the current composition building. And in 1980s building, the flashover occurs at 12 minutes, while in the current building it occurs at 3.5 minutes.
So they are more dangerous.
Very dangerous. Very drastic difference is seen.
So now there is another question from the same person, Reshman. How was the flat or apartment culture affected the evaluation of the fire control techniques? After looking at this, have they changed in the fire control is a question.
No, the point actually is fire control actually built for the apartment category. If you look at our regular, let's say, Jayanagar area, if you say Jayanagar or normal extension area, if you say, where there are no high rise or there are no 4-floor, 5-floor buildings. Under such circumstances, we don't have any fire safety things happening. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
There are no problems. While because of the apartment culture, the fire safety has become mandated. Especially if you look at basement of any apartment, you see all sprinklers, spray nozzles are in place, and awareness has come. An awareness has come because of the apartment culture. In the fire safety, and I'm sure earlier we were neglecting. I think people are now becoming more conscious. I must also share with you, I live in a 12 floor apartment where power was cut for 1 week because we did not renew our fire extinguisher.
Okay, so to that extent, they have become very conscious about it.
Yes.
And one last question regarding the oil fire. People say that suppose I say in a kadai, there is an oil and it catches fire. What is the best way to immediately put it off?
The when there is an oil fire, I want to first to tell you the worst way to do it is putting water on it. The moment you put water on it, oil particles will explode because water being lighter, it will go and settle at the drop and then evaporate. And then break the oil layer and you will have oil splattering all over you, which is very dangerous. So the best way of putting that is you just cover the kadai with certain vessel so that if it is possible, you can cover it with certain steel plate or anything which is available to you. So allow it to, it will immediately suffocate out of its own gases. And then the fire will get extinguished. And when the oil cools, you can remove the cover. That is one kitchen, especially in kitchen environment, that can be done.
There is a last question here. What type of facilities do you have in your laboratory, and what from your university?
Currently, our laboratory is a research center. Our laboratory is a research center. One of our major income comes from our collaboration with Underwriters Laboratories, with whom we test the fire safe active fire suppression products. Describe to you what are suppression products. The entire spectrum of fire suppression products, not fire protection products. Fire suppression products we test, and then the UL certifies those products, and in the process income is generated. We are working on developing students for research who are interested in the focused in research, so that first we are in the capacity acquiring mode, capacity development mode. We want to have enough capacity, so the enough research scholars are there, and a PhD is being awarded right now. That is we have two students working for the PhD in our center. We want to start an undergraduate program once we have enough linkages with the industry, so that they can be placed well.
Thank you very much, sir, for coming on to the webinar. Your rich experience has definitely helped us. Probably we will have some more sessions from you a little later. And thanks a lot for coming. And I should be thankful to the Amity University authorities for making a platform like this. And all of us know that a series of such webinars are being done. More than I think 500 have already been done. Very nice webinars. And I thank all my authorities as well in the campus also for permitting us to conduct this particular webinar. Thank you all, and thanks to the participants for coming and asking some interesting questions as well. Thank you, sir.
I thank the participants for being part of this and look forward to continuous interactions wherever possible. because you know our center or capabilities, please be in touch with us. I can share my email with Dr. Sridhar, which can be circulated among the participants.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.